So we'll show you some technical results later, but kind of a high level. The question for today is SOS and optimal algorithm. So that would be kind of the first to be, and this is kind of the motivation for what we want to ask. And I guess before we ask this question, we should ask maybe some more basic question, such that what is an optimal algorithm? What do we mean by that? Should one exist? I mean, before we even ask the question, is SOS an optimal algorithm? Is there any reason why there should be an optimal algorithm, regardless of whether it's SOS or something like that? And then, if so, why SOS and not, I don't know what, something else? So to define the notion of an optimal algorithm, you kind of need to restrict attention to some kind of domain. And let me talk about NP optimization problems. So you're going to think about the following thing. Say NP maximization. Maximization or minimization really doesn't matter. Just picks one of them. So the input is some function from 0,1 to the n to say 0,1 in some kind of an efficient representation, some kind of a representation that allows us to evaluate this function. And the goal is to say find x in 0,1 n that maximizes f. And generally, so we'll define opt f to be the maximum value. And given for any algorithm A, we just define a of f to be f of x, and x is output. Okay, so I've overloaded a of f a little bit. A of f, I sometimes think of it as the string that it outputs, and sometimes the quality of this value, but it will be kind of clear from context. So, okay, and you know, for example, like, if you think of say max cut, then if the input is g, then we just define like f g of x to be a fraction of edges cut. Right, so max cut is a special case of this thing. We just think like we interpret the input as a function, where basically given any bipartition which we can encode as a string, it gives the value. And say small set expansion, we would define something like, you know, f of x would be maybe zero if then x is larger than some delta n, and otherwise would be, I don't know, 1 minus number of edges from s to its complement normalized. Right, so this is a, you know, basically
any NP problem, you can just write it this way. This is not like any restriction or anything like that. And we can, in many cases, this F is also going to be a low degree polynomial. So in such cases, it's very natural to write, let's say, an SOS program for it. So now we want, so what is a computational problem? So basically, we cannot think of a set of all possible Fs. Particularly, we don't know how to evaluate them. We can think of set of all Fs that are represented by small circuits, but then we'll get kind of meaningless things where every algorithm is optimal because no algorithm can do anything. So in some sense, what we're interested in is looking at some kind of a restriction. So we define a computational problem is simply some collection F, Fn, where Fn is a subset of all functions from 0, 1, n, 2. And say the performance of A on F would be, say, the limit, say the upper limit as n goes to infinity. Let's say the maximum, the worst case thing, so the maximum of F in Fn of the opt of F minus A of F. Okay, so this is kind of like one natural way to define how well an algorithm performs on a computational problem. And now we can make some definition, right? So we can just say define, we say that A is T epsilon optimal. The smallest, the way I define it is this: if it's zero, it's optimal, right? So, plus epsilon. Okay. So
is the performance supposed to be the minimum over F?
So it's supposed to be the maximum. I think the worst case, right? So performance means that. Every problem will have like trivial instances, so there are always some instances where you can get the optimum. So in some sense, the performance is the worst case instance. And right, an algorithm is purely optimal if it just outputs the optimal thing, period. But that's, of course, if P is different from NP, we don't expect an efficient algorithm that just outputs the optimum. But when we say that an algorithm is optimal, what we think is that it's basically as good as any other algorithm that runs in comparable time. So, and there may be more than one way to formalize it. There is definitely more than one way to formalize it. This is just like a kind of a reasonable way to study it. And you can also ask this question this is kind of a worst case additive notion. You can ask questions about worst case multiplicative notions. You can ask, though maybe by taking logs it's basically the same, or you can ask questions about average case, or even instance based optimality. But you have to be just a little bit careful if you talk about instance based optimality, because you want to avoid this situation where you know, there could be a trivial algorithm that just remembers, you know, the answer. You know, it's like this joke that every clock, you know, even a clock that doesn't move shows the right time twice a day. So, you know, there could be like a trivial algorithm that still that still solves the problem on very particular instances. So.
So you sometimes have to be a little bit careful in how you define it and kind of see it in the LRS result.
But generally speaking, this is a reasonable definition. Now there's a question. Before we even ask if sum of squares satisfies this definition, we should ask whether whether we should expect that that anything should satisfy this definition, or anything non-trivial, yes?
Why do we, with the case of the limit rather than looking at, like, for example, the order the error grows down, right? I mean, something could have an error of like 1/n, and one could have 1/n². Surely you think 1/n² is more optimal?
Right, so I guess this is kind of a notion of optimality up to some epsilon, and I guess more generally, you could ask maybe some fair version where epsilon is kind of a function of n or something like that. So I guess looking ahead, I would imagine that, I mean, even having some squares be optimal in this additive epsilon sense would be very, like, if constant epsilon would be, like, for arbitrarily small epsilon would be amazing. And somehow, so I feel like studying a weaker definition. But maybe going back to your question, here is a theorem. For every t, which is a time complexity function, you know, not something too crazy, say monotone, computable or whatever. So time valid time complexity function. There is a Tn poly n time algorithm that is optimal for every f. That is T0 optimal. And the proof is basically the following. So our algorithm A on input F will do the following: enumerate, you know, M1 to Mn, you know, first n Turing machines, and output, you know, run each for Tn steps to get you know, x1 to xn, you know, some of them maybe they will run too long, you will just, you know, throw out those outputs, and then output best one, right? Xi that maximizes it. Right, so the running time here would be like, you know, n times tn, that's the time to evaluate the f, or you know, it's basically tn poly n or something like that. So there is an optimal algorithm, but there is something, right, if when you see this proof, it somehow doesn't feel very satisfying. We don't feel that we have learned a lot from this proof. I mean, it's not completely clear that we haven't learned anything. Like, you could imagine a priori that for every different computation problem will require kind of a different idea, and somehow there will be an infinite number of possible algorithms for every problem. So it's kind of nice to know that you can. This is kind of a lesson that we've learned time and again, and with these kind of generalization things. So now we want to, okay, we we don't like the answer, or at least I don't like the answer. And so we want to somehow redefine the question. Yes?
Is there any scenario where we know such another? I mean, for that, even very simple problems, we know the kind of things that
we... I mean, there are some situations where we have, tight hardness results, where you basically say, here is a problem, this trivial algorithm gives performance, blah on it, and we can prove that it's NP-hard to give performance better than blah. So that says you prove that this trivial algorithm is optimal. So for example, for FreeSat, we know that outputting a random assignment is optimal if you're talking about the notion of worst case approximation, which is kind of like what we're talking about right now. So let's say outputting a random assignment for a threesat is an epsilon and even little of one optimal algorithm with respect to any, assuming that the ETH with respect to any T that is like 2 to the little of n. So we don't like, I don't like this answer, so I want to rephrase the question. Should a nice optimal algorithm exist? So you can ask, what does it mean to be nice, right? So so one answer is this, I think I mentioned before, the same answer like pornography, I know it when I see it. So that's one version, one answer. Another one related to it is you don't want to use diagonalization. But of course, you can hide diagonalization in lots of ways, so it's not a very well-defined statement. Another thing that's more concrete is that it's simple enough for unconditional or bound. So somehow, for very concrete algorithms, like some squares, we have seen it, we have shown limitations of these algorithms, that there are things that they cannot do. And for this algorithm, it's kind of obvious that if you show that it doesn't solve a problem, then you've basically, proven that P is different from NP, etc. And the reason I want unconditional or bound is not because I don't believe the assumptions, I believe that P is different from NP, it's not a problem. My problem with using assumptions is not that they might not be true. My problem is that basically, when you show unconditional low bounds, it means you understand this algorithm. You understand it enough to analyze it, so it's kind of useful. It's something that somehow shows that it's more than some tautology. So you want it to be kind of so it's another notion of being simple, and related to that, we would want it maybe to tie to other mathematical notions. So we can use tools like maybe geometry, analysis, etc., to understand it. So in some sense, computation is very hard, and what we want to do, an optimal algorithm, the idea is that it should help us. It would be nice if it helps us, it converts problems about computation to maybe problems that are somewhat more concrete. And so now we know that some optimal algorithm exists, but why should it be a nice one? Like maybe a priori, in fact, like computation is very complicated, maybe you don't expect a nice algorithm to exist. And there are, I guess, so they don't really have a good answer to this. One answer is that it would be really, really cool. So you know, if, because basically what a nice algorithm, a nice optimal algorithm means that basically we have some kind of a way to, you know, take, to partition the problems that are easy or hard, but by some kind of a clean criteria, you know, so, basically we say this is where the nice algorithm works, and this is where nothing works. And this is really, will really be very, very nice if we could do it. So, you know, so one thing is that, you know, we could say, you know, it would be really, really cool. We really, really want to it. We have good people, you know, we have, I don't know, donated to the right causes, etc. Then why shouldn't we get something nice? And, you know, it's been a bad year. So that's one reason, although that's probably you know, the fact that you really want something doesn't always mean that you get it, as I know. So what other reasons do we have to expect that a nice algorithm would exist? So one of them is that if you actually open, you know, graduate algorithm textbook, or generally an algorithm textbook, especially if one that focuses on optimization, then, you know, I haven't actually done it, but people that have tell me that the chapters there kind of have repeating themes. It's not that basically it's a collection of, you know, 200 chapters, each one of them has, you know, for a different problem, there is a very different ad hoc idea that solves this problem. But rather, there are some kind of repeating themes that keep again recurring again and again. You know, greedy algorithms, convexity, and, you know, mathematical relaxations, etc. So these are kind of things that you know, divide and conquer. So these are things that are repeating themes, which tell us that maybe, you know, there is a rich space of problems. But there are like some big broad ideas that somehow cover like large fraction of these problems. So maybe, you know, a nice optimal algorithm will correspond to maybe one idea and maybe optimal in some kind of significant chunk of the problem space. And here there is another reason which here I'm venturing even far beyond my expertise, but I have also been told that in practice, when people actually want to solve optimization problems, they don't code up a different algorithm for every problem. Rather, there are like general optimization packages that get used again and again. And this again indicates that maybe there, you know, it's not that every different problem requires a completely different algorithm, but maybe there is kind of one general thing that can be used again and again. So I think this kind of state of art, both in theory and practice, kind of suggests that if you're trying to ask whether a problem is just inherently easy or inherently hard, you might only need one or two general principles, while if you're trying to, well, you need a lot of ad hoc tricks to either, you know, really squeeze out the performance for this problem, which could be very important, or like, you know, shave. Also asymptotic performance, like, you know, shave an exponent for this problem, which could be very important. Or sometimes what happens in theory papers is that you modify the algorithm, but not because the general simple one doesn't work necessarily, but because it makes the analysis easier. So you have a lot of ad hoc ideas that are really there to facilitate the analysis rather than that we know that they are inherently necessary. So it seems consistent with you know, current practice, etc., that some nice algorithm could exist that at least will cover like significant swath of problem space. And I hope that I kind of motivated why, if this is possibly the case, we kind of want to really investigate it and find out if it's true. And then, of course, even if you kind of buy the notion that one could hope for a nice algorithm, you could ask why SOS. And again, maybe not, but it does seem like convex optimization. Convex optimization is very much a recurring theme in many questions. So you can ask whether now you can try to prove some results actually, like not just pontificate, so about SOS. So you could ask, for example, can we show, you know, is SOS optimal for convex optimization? And again, it's kind of a very general question. We don't know how to answer it. You can even ask if SOS is optimal for SDP. This is still a general question, because semi-definite programming, even linear programming, is p-complete. So it means you can basically encode any arbitrary computation in an SDP program. So basically, trying to prove this would be just trying to prove that it's optimal period. But we can ask for is SDP optimal for, say, nice formulations of SDPs. And what we'll see in this lecture is this very, very nice result of Leo Gamendel-Soto, that basically they say yes for a restricted case, but still a very interesting one. And I should also say that when we're talking about worst case approximation results, you can also prove, sometimes you can basically prove, NP different than P implies SOS optimal. And for certain CSPs, this was shown by Chan 13. The thing that's a little bit less, is a little bit less satisfying about here is that basically it didn't really show that sum of squares is optimal. It showed that on certain CSPs where sum of squares doesn't give, basically that gives trivial performance, every algorithm also gives trivial performance. So it basically showed that the trivial algorithm is optimal for these CSPs, but the class of CSPs is chosen basically based on what on SOS know about. And basically, and this is modeled in the game conjecture, then this is true for all CSPs. As I mentioned, this is the result of Fred Ventura. But I feel like, again, this I still care, even though you can basically prove this possibly, I mean, I very much deeply care to understand if we can remove the UGC here, or of course, what people are trying to do is prove the UGC, which basically will be this. But a big question mark.
The question?
Yes. So is it a more refined way of thinking about the optimality of an algorithm rather than just for a worst case instance?
Yes.
I mean, this is, the problem is, of course, out of like you're saying for FreeSat, right? Like, there are certain instances for which a random algorithm will do as well as SOS or FreeSat. But for most instances,
yes.
Let's say pretty much any instance that one cares about.
Yes.
The random algorithm
was horrible. Right. So I think it's very interesting to understand kind of instance-based complexity. And there, basically, these kind of NP different from P-based results are kind of non-starter. But LRS-type results, I think, they formally state it in the language of worst-case complexity. it really is basically instance.
Yeah, so LOS is basically instance. Show that SOS is instance optimal, as we kind of see.
So, so
basically this is our focus would be this result of Leo Agamendo and Storer, and it will take us some time to prove it, and we'll probably even not get to see the full proof, but we'll get to see the ideas behind the proofs, which are actually very interesting in their own. But let me at least kind of state the result. So okay, so now basically I want to state this LOS result. The question is okay. Maybe I'll start by stating a corollary, and then I'll start by stating a corollary, and then state the actual result. So okay. So. So we have to say, what does it mean to be? What does it mean to talk about the general? Okay, so LRS basically saying that for every, let's say with CSP, but it's more general than that. But let's say for the satisfaction problem, SOS of the degree D is roughly as bits. Any SDP of degree n to the of size of n to the little of the constraints. And this is a very, very vague thing, and the any will be with some caveats. So to avoid trivialities and avoid things we don't know how to prove. And also the n to the little of d, there are like some kind of conditions on what d exactly you can, how big of d you can make. You still have this statement, so, but this is roughly speaking. So basically, sum of squares, the sum of squares PSD is some way to write a positive semi-definite program where you put n to the d constraints corresponding to the degree d polynomials. And basically, I always say that it doesn't help you to put any other set of constraints. There is no kind of clever way to do it. And so, what? So for that, we kind of let me try to formalize this more. So basically, let's say that if you have a subspace of R2 to the n. This is basically this set of functions from 0,1 to the n to R. So if it's a subspace, then we say that f from 0,1 the n to R has u proof of non-negativity if f equal to sum over ui squared, or sum ui's, for the ui's in D. Right. So SOS. SOS corresponds to. SOS corresponds to the subspace of all low degree polynomials. But in a general SDP, basically the way we'll think about it, it corresponds to some arbitrary subset. So, maybe I'll do one change here. I'll change this n into m, consistent with future notation. Or maybe not. Okay.
Let's stick with it. Sorry. Okay. So. Okay. So now let's formally say or let's have our say LRS theorem is basically saying the following. Here is one version of it that is not exactly true, but we'll make it more true. Basically, if f has u proof, you know, proof of non-negative, the dimension of u is say n to the d, then it has, some O tilde of the SOS proof. And maybe that it has, maybe we are willing to, you know,
lose a little bit that we say it has another SOS proof that it is at least minus epsilon. Okay? So this is kind of the theorem, this would be kind of instance optimality of SOS. And this is kind of theorem that we would have liked to prove, but unfortunately, it's not true for kind of it cannot be true for a very kind of trivial reason. Do you see why?
Lots of subspaces, not very many SOS proofs, probably something like that.
Maybe to some extent, or even something like that. You take a single F0, take an F0 which is non-negative. And taking the F0 which is non-negative and has no, say little of an SOS proof, and just define U to be the subspace that just contains square root of F0. There is something, this is this kind of triviality of instance-based optimality. But this is somehow not really a problem, right? That's okay. We are not worried about semi-definite programs. That's our half programmed inside. They know exactly the input which we have. So now what we want to say is the following thing. We'll say. We get rid of this problem by a very simple thing that renaming the variables. So basically what we want to say is the following thing. So we kind of phrase this in the contrapositive version. We say, suppose this is now at this point this is almost like the actual LRS theorem. I think the only differences are now quantitative, which I probably always get wrong throughout this lecture, so it doesn't really matter. So the LRS theorem would say the following: suppose that f from z1 to m to r has no SOS proof with that f is at least minus epsilon, then we can define a g from 0,1 to m to r. Then for every u in r 2 to the n, and there will be some n which is like m to the o of d or something like that. This is the greedy, of course. So for every u of dimension, say, less than m or n to the o of d, there will exist a function which is basically the same as f, just applying it on some subset of the variable, so that g of x is simply f of x apply to S, where S is some subset, M-size subset, without a U proof of non-negativity. So in some sense,
One way to think about it is the following. Say, suppose that there is this graph G on m vertices, such that sum of squares cannot, the true maximum cut, the max cut of G is at most some, is equal to alpha, but SOS only certifies a bound of beta. Then basically, what we show is that for every subspace, for every U. So you take U, which is a subset of R2 to the n, then there is going to be a graph which is just G, but just on a subset of the vertices. So basically, this is a graph where, completely doesn't touch these vertices, just G, where the same thing holds up to some small epsilon, the same thing holds with respect to this general SDP program U. So the general SDP program, basically we kind of get rid of the problem that it could encode a particular function by a very simple thing, which we basically say, well, you have to, if you work for one function, you have to work also for this function applied to, if we rename the variables. So, and this turns out to be enough. So this, in particular, this implies that for any constraint satisfaction problem, basically sum of squares, the performance of sum of squares is as good as the performance of any other SDP. And you can see that basically it's really instance optimality because the two instances are basically the same instance after renaming of the variables. Okay, so this is the statement of the theorem. Maybe I'll try to write it. Let's see. So maybe I'll kind of write it because we're gonna take a long time until we come back to actually proving it. So the theorem is the following: for every f from 0,1 to the n to say -1 + 1, so it's kind of a bounded function. If there exists a degree d pseudo distribution mu such that mu f is like minus 0.1, then for some say m, which I think m over d would be good enough, and every u in R to the n with the dimension of u in R, which is much smaller, let's say n to the little o of d or something like that, then for every u of this form, there exists some subset s of n choose n, such that GS of x substituted to S has no U proof of nullity. Yes?
Sorry, this is not a particularly well-formed question.
Yes.
But the theorem seems to be saying something like, if you have some problem that SOS has trouble solving,
yes,
then you can obscure the problem in a way such that other programs also have trouble solving the problem.
Well, it's not exactly obscure, right? It's basically the same problem, the exact same problem.
Sure, but it's still saying like there exists a way of representing the problem such that other programs have trouble solving the problem. Is that somehow it feels different from what we want? It seems like just because there's one way of phrasing the problem such that other SDPs can't solve it doesn't mean that there aren't other ways of phrasing the problem that SDPs can't solve.
Right, but I guess the way I would say it is that it's not really rephrasing the problem, it is the same problem, because you basically what you're saying is so let's get kind of say if SOS can't certify that X1 XM is non-negative, then no other SDP can certify that FXI1 XIM is non-negative. So you could basically say that any one way to say it is that to avoid the notion of talking about this, you could say that say define some notion of a reasonable programming hierarchy, and you say a reasonable programming hierarchy does not take care about renaming of variables. If it can, if it succeeds for if it can certify, which is like the case for SOS, right? If it can certify that this is non-negative, it should also be able to certify it if it's the first n variable.
Okay, and then this theorem would imply that programming hierarchies can't solve the same problem.
Yes,
okay.
Yes. So then it would imply instance optimality. Yes, so, well, in this sense, you have to do something like that to just avoid the notion of encoding the actual solution. Yes?
So basically, why don't we take a break and give you time to kind of stare at this statement and make sure that you understand it. We're gonna take the cynic route to proving this this result and go talk about some other results that are so it will take an extra 2 minutes. Stay with me. So like I said, we are going to take the kind of cynic route to this proof of the theorem and do a digression. I want to talk about some results that I'm sure you've seen some of them. There's kind of a large, very large collection of results that all have some kind of common spread. So one is, LP duality. And there is the Hahn-Banach theorem in functional analysis. Minimax theorem of von Neumann in game theory. This notion of regret minimization. Expert learning, etc. Boosting in ML. The hardcore lemma. The Dennis model theorem, which was theorem that was kind of crucial in additive combinatorics to prove for the proof by Green and Tao that the primes have arbitrary long arithmetic progressions, and probably other kind of theorems that kind of fall into that general theme, and I think they all. To me, what seems the common thread in these things is that I think each one of them
might be, at least to me, somewhat counterintuitive the first time you hear about it. It might be surprising that it's actually true. And it turns out to be very, very, very useful. And it's actually, once you get the dev to, you know, believe that something like that could be true, these things are not that hard to prove. And typically, the way you prove them is by some kind of iterative procedure or local improvement algorithm, local search algorithm, whether it's like gradient descent of some type or this multiplicative weights algorithm. And will that just fix one of them and show the proof?
Now, some of you have seen it, but I think it's still useful because we're going to generalize it.
So, and these are, you know, I think it's, if you kind of understand, you really understand this paradigm, it's a very useful, it's very
useful no matter
what you do. So,
I'm kind of,
what do you do?
Really try to pick one of those which is kind of your favorite and really understand it, also understand its connection to other things.
So, okay, so let's just prove one of these results. I'll talk about, regret minimization. So,
this is Harvard, so I assume most of you have like large portfolios of stocks that you invest in. So suppose the following thing: there is, you know, you in some universe of assets. Mu is a distribution over mu. This is an investment strategy. You can even think of it as basically you have $1 million and mu is how you spread them across the assets, or you know, you have $1 and you choose a random asset according to mu and invest your dollar in it. It doesn't matter. And we're thinking of the following game. There is the investor and the market, and at every given point in time, the investor comes up with some distribution mu2. The market comes with a function that says how well everything performs. So some ft, ft from u to say -1 +1, and the gain of the investor is the expectation according to mu t of ft.
And we basically, what we want in such an investment strategy is we want to minimize the regret we have. So basically, and you have to think about it, because this FT could be kind of arbitrary and depend on mu2. So the reasonable notion of the regret is to say we want to compare to the best strategy in hindsight. So we want to minimize the maximum over all mu star of the gain of mu star minus our gain. Where, you know, the gain of mu star is sum over all t mu star ft, while our gain is sum over all t expectation of mu t. Okay, so this is the setting of regret minimization. And I think it's kind of, I mean, it might seem like a hopeless setting, like, you know, can you invest, can you kind of invest in the stock market every day and have something that mathematically guarantees that you would have as good performance as someone that, you know, knew to invest in Apple like 30 years ago, just stuck with Apple. And it turns out that you can. So you can get sublinear regret in some sense. You can get like little, little of t. And the basic theorem, which not absolutely sure in this exact form who proved it. I think the general kind of notions of regret minimization comes back to, I think sublinear comes back to Hanan in 57 and Littlestone and Wormuth might have been in 89, might have been the first to did square root, and then Freund and Shapiro also. So maybe this version is due to Freund and Shapiro. And the result is the following. For every, you know, say we let eta be some parameter that we can choose to be some small number, then for every mu1, mu2, mu capital T, we can define, sorry, F1, Ft, we can define mu t based only on F1 till Ft minus 1. And such that we get the following, our gain is at least one minus O of eta. The gain, the gain of the, of the of some. So this is for every mu star. You can get that for every mu star, we'll get that our gain will be at least the gain of mu star plus one over eta, the KL divergence of mu star from our initial distribution mu one. And in particular, as a corollary, if we let U1 be, you know, uniform over U, and we let eta be square root log U over T, then you know, then if, then basically the kind of our regret is going to be something like O of square root log U over T. So, let me call the KL divergence, our regret is going to be square root log U T, which is kind of, the important thing is kind of sublinear right? So if you play this for many, many periods, then eventually our kind of regret, amortized regret, goes to zero. Okay? So this is the theorem. Let me... how many of you have seen this proof? It's a very good fraction.
What's that's a reading group?
In the reading group, but yeah, no, it wasn't a reading group. I'm surprised that you remember. Okay, so let me kind of just say the outline for those who didn't see it or don't remember. The outline is very simple. So I should say the proof outline because it is we do want to say something about what the proof gives us. So basically, you want to say mu t is just proportional to mu t of x
is going to just be proportional to mu t minus 1 of x times 2 to the eta f t minus 1 of x. So basically, if f is your gain, often this we talk about f as the loss and then it's a minus sign, but it's the same thing. So if f is your gain, you want to give more weight to the x's that to the x's that had like higher f and less weight to the other one. So you kind of rescale things like that, and you know, the proportionality, you know, zt would be the proportionality factor would be like expectation of with mu t of to the eta ft minus 1. So this would be like the proportionality factor to make this distribution, and then you do some kind of the analysis. You do telescopic sum. You compare. You basically look at delta mu star mu t minus delta mu star, say mu t minus 1 minus mu t, and you do some calculations. You upper bound it. You sum up this telescopic sum, and you get the result. Okay, so this is just some calculations. Okay, yada yada yada, QED. okay, so now that we have seen this ironclad proof, which appears in the notes, because, by the way, typically the theorem is framed with losses, and I don't know why I decided to frame it with gains. Then, if you see the proof in the notes, every minus sign has like some probability that it should be a plus instead. But I conjecture that there is a way, there is a signing of the. realignment of the signs that make this into a valid proof, by the way, talking about these things, there is actually several sources. So there is a survey of Fazan, Kale, and Aroa on multiplicative weights algorithm that is very useful. And there is actually a book by Bubek, who gave the talk in the reading group, book on, I think it's called Convex Optimization or something like that. And you can look at the chapter on, say, mirror, gradient descent. So it talks about a lot of these things. So this is, and there are more resources, and there are some citations in the LRS paper itself.
There's also a book by Adam, that's like pretty good.
Ah, I didn't know that. Ah, that's good to know.
Or it's written as corpus, but it has a lot of
people. Okay, I should look it up. So I didn't even know that. So that's useful to know. So the proof that we didn't see actually gives us a little bit more than just the statement, and that's actually going to be useful. But we can actually already see, in some sense, what it gives us is the following: that the investment strategies mu t. Or say the final strategy is kind of like, you can think of it as a convex combination of all these strategies. So is so the strategy is simple. What does it mean that it's simple? It's basically of the form like E or 2 to some you know, eta. So it's kind of proportional to some alpha I fi. From I to 1 to some L, where basically the complexity, say the L is like the complexity And it says as if we want epsilon accuracy, then L is just O of the divergence between U star